Chapter 2. Against the Wind. We were running against the wind. We were young and strong. We were running against the wind. Well, I'm older now, and still running against the wind. Bob Seger. Entrepreneurs and great businesses are always going against the wind. If you are in business, no matter what goal or journey you decide to pursue, you are always going to meet resistance and find yourself moving against the wind. In order to change, improve, or innovate, you will find yourself going against the flow of the status quo. For example, before I started Real Truck, I worked as a manufacturer's rep for a company that represented about 15 pickup truck accessory and equipment manufacturers. I was always searching for better and more efficient ways to do things. As I was calling on dealers, I was sure there had to be an easier way to sell products. This was at a time when ordering through the internet was just beginning. I placed my first order on staples.com, and I was quite impressed that my order showed up at my house a few days later. One of the products my company represented at the time, Northwest Representations, Inc., was the Access roll-up cover made by Agri-Cover, Inc. We set up dealers across the Northwest United States and also attended retailer and industry trade shows. I would call on pickup accessory stores and show them the products we represented. From snowplows to pickup bed covers from various manufacturers around the United States. If they liked our products, we signed them up as a dealer, and then Northwest reps would get paid a commission on the sales from those dealers in a given geographical area, often referred to as independent agents, manufacturer agents, or manufacturer representatives. At the retail trade shows, boat, car, sports shows, and so forth, we would show products and then refer consumers to the local dealers we had set up to buy whatever product they were interested in. This was a lot of work, and I thought there had to be a way to speed up the process. For the pickup bed cover we offered at the time, we felt the only way to sell the bed cover was to show it on a pickup, roll it open, and roll it closed. We decided to try a new approach to marketing by creating a television commercial. TV or trade shows. I thought TV was a way to show the product and not have to attend 50 trade shows a year. Our hope was that we could sell more covers and mitigate our cost while increasing our sales. TV was seen as a marketing tool for large companies, but somehow I managed to talk Agri-Cover and three of their dealers into funding the TV commercial. It was a lot of fun to make the commercial, although we doubted a 30-second spot would work. Splitting the cost four ways lowered the financial risk, and with a little persuasion, we tried it. The TV commercial was a success, and we sold a lot more access covers. The financial risk had paid off. This got me thinking about getting someone to build a website. What if we build a website, somehow converted the TV ad to a video, and put that on the site, set it up so you could order? Again, e-commerce was the Wild West at that time. I asked Agri-Cover, and they didn't want to do it. I asked the three dealers, and they didn't want to do it. I started trying to convince the brick-and-mortar pickup accessory stores that this was the way of the future and a new vertical for revenue for their stores. I had no success. None. Then I decided, what if I do it? I had a friend going to college for web development. He needed some extra cash for college, so maybe he would be willing to build it. My plan was to get a website built, then show my pickup accessory accounts that it worked, and they could sell online. If I could do it, then they certainly could do it, as they had more resources than I did. If we could sell more products, then I could stop attending trade shows. I asked Agri-Cover if it was all right to try my little experiment, and to my surprise, they said sure, but at my expense. And so the RealTruck.com story began. Real Truck begins. My initial vision to get the factory and the brick-and-mortar stores to set up websites to sell their products was unsuccessful. They did not want to pay for and put resources behind the development of websites. They were focused on their right-now business and not on the future. But none of us really had any idea how enormously crazy big that selling on the internet would become. Realtruck.com initially was just going to be a prototype to show brick-and-mortar stores and pickup accessory manufacturers in order to get them to sell their products online. I was terribly unsuccessful convincing most of them. I did convince a few, but they would not provide the resources to make it successful, or they would put up a website with a few products, no online checkout, and a big phone number to call to place the order. Meanwhile, at Realtruck headquarters, which was the basement of a duplex, I kept trying to push the bar by adding products to the website. The original three products were the access roll-up cover, the pop and lock tailgate lock, and the bed rug bed liner. The best qualified to sell online. Even though the manufacturers, wholesalers, and pickup truck accessory stores were more well-equipped to be successful selling online, they had better resources in terms of money, people, products, business experience, experts in their area. They lacked two essential ingredients: open-mindedness and passion. It was up to my little rep firm to take up the task of selling pickup accessories online. Anytime there is a new road or network to connect people, it will always shift business, whether you agree with it or not. The Postal Service made way for the Sears catalog and other mail-order companies. The interstate road system made way for big-box retail stores. TV made way for the home shopping network and other TV shopping channels. The internet made way for e-commerce companies such as Amazon and Realtruck. The mobile phone is now the newest network connecting people in ways never seen before. When you're going against the direction of the current business wind, you have to accept you're not going to win a popularity contest. Most of the feedback you get will be around why it won't work. It's like a little train with not much of an engine, but get that engine going in a certain direction, and slowly more and more people will get on board. Not everyone will board your train. They don't like the train, they don't think it will work, or they think it's a waste of time. Others may hop on, but then jump off because it's going too slow and they can't see where it's going to take them. The more people get on board, the stronger the engine becomes. Most game-changing ideas are not accepted right away, and often those best able to capitalize on them won't. This is because of what Jim Collins covers in masterly detail in his book, Good to Great. You will not be great if you deny the brutal facts of the market situation. Jumping on a new road, for me, was life-changing. The brutal facts. Don't think for a minute life is like a Monopoly game, where you roll the dice and if you work hard, you will be rewarded fairly. That may have been true at one time, but not anymore. Don't get me wrong, you can be successful, but don't kid yourself about how the board of life is set up. Starting like I did with a single mom who was a waitress living in a trailer park, you quickly realize a few things. In the real world, all the properties and resources are already owned by other people, often for generations. If you're just starting like I did, you probably only have one die to roll, with most of the numbers missing. Others may have 6 and 7 complete dice to roll. Some even have dice with a 6 on every side. When I went past go, I'd get $5 when others were getting $100 and others $1,000. This doesn't mean you can't overcome adversity. It just means you need to be aware of the brutal facts of the situation. You can't get better at the game if you don't know all the rules and pitfalls. This means it's even more important to master skills, find mentors, and take risks. Skills have value, especially if others know what you have in your tool belt. Mentors can speed up the learning curve and help you develop skills faster. This new network, the internet, along with my willingness to risk it with really nothing to lose, is what changed the Monopoly game of life. Obstacles and more obstacles. I had to overcome some obstacles before I officially started Realtruck. I chatted with my buddy who was going to school for web development. He was ready to jump on, and we figured out his hourly pay. He started part-time with the goal of getting an online store set up. To do this, we needed to get an internet connection at his apartment and my house. At the time, dial-up was the only option we knew of. We needed a domain name, hosting, and email. My friend called around and asked me to meet him at an attorney's office. We met, and the dial-up internet and hosting company was conveniently located in an unused back room of the attorney's office. It was a bit sketchy. We told the owner of the internet provider company our plans, and that we needed dial-up and server hosting. He asked what is now an obvious question. What was the name of the company domain we wanted? Shit, I hadn't even thought of one. The dial-up guy started rattling off ideas. One of them was RealTruck. About 3 months into the project, my website guy called and said the server's gone. No dial-up, no hosting. Thankfully, he had a backup of everything. We panicked, shot up to the attorney's office, and went to the back room to find nothing there. He had bolted. However, he must have originally wanted to be a straight shooter, because when he registered the domain RealTruck, he registered it to me. We found another dial-up and hosting company and continued development. The next hurdle was to set up credit card processing. This almost killed the deal. First, for a virtual store at the time, it was almost impossible to explain what kind of business we were planning on doing. Selling online was new. Virtual stores were unheard of. You don't have a storefront? You don't stock any product? How are you going to have customers? How are you going to swipe their card? We finally found a credit card processor, but I had to sign a 3-year lease at $40 a month. This delayed things for about a week as I pondered it. I thought, what if everyone is right and we don't sell anything? I'll have this stupid $40 a month payment for 3 years. Which I couldn't really afford at the time. Clearly, you know the decision I made. I signed up for the manual credit card processing machine, which had to be plugged into a telephone line to work, also costing another $50 a month. A few months later, in November 1998, the website was published. We had a homepage, 3 product pages, a cart, and checkout process, along with a video loaded on the website of the TV commercial we made. It looked badass at the time. As good fortune would have it, that evening, RealTruck got its first sale. A gentleman from the great state of Tennessee ordered an access cover for his short bed 1997 Ford F-150. This created another dilemma. I technically didn't have accounts with the manufacturers to order any of the 3 products on the site offered. I printed the order form from the website and purged it. None of the manufacturers or wholesalers really had much for email at the time. Everything was done via fax or phone. If they did have an email, it was on one computer. Everyone in the company used it, and it was checked maybe once a week. I manually keyed in the credit card number into my shiny new credit card processing machine. It dialed and captured the funds. The next morning, I called Chuck, one of the owners of Agri-Cover, Inc., and asked if I could set up a buying account with him. He said yes. So on a Word document, I wrote up the purchase order along with the ship-to address and faxed the order in. Agri-Cover shipped it via UPS using the same fax and faxed back tracking information. I then retyped the tracking number into the email, thanked the customer for ordering, and included the tracking number. Holy smokes. This was crazy cool. That seemed pretty automated at the time. My next problem was I didn't really know anything about accounting. I knew the credit card processor was going to put the funds into my bank account in a few days, and Agri-Cover would be mailing a bill due in 30 days. I didn't realize it at the time, but this would be a big ingredient in being able to grow as fast as our operations could keep up with things. Get paid in 4 to 5 days, and not have to pay the product cost for 30 days. Later, most suppliers would let you pay in 10 days and get a 2% discount. Over time, we realized we could grow as fast as we could sell, process orders, and post tracking. I called a friend from college, Keith, who was my only 4.0 GPA friend, and asked him if he would do the books to start. He said yes. Keith lived in a different town, so each week I would mail him all the orders and bills. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was picking up another awareness. You can't do everything and be good at it. Focus on what you're good at and let others help you with what you're not good at. I'm more of a risk taker and a get it done kind of a person, not a money organizer or planner. Not once did I wish to know how to web develop or do accounting. Often folks are shocked to find out that I don't know how to do web development. When it comes to web development, I'm more wired to connect dots and ideas and then knock down mental or physical obstacles that stand in the way of someone else being able to write code and turn that idea into a reality. My favorite thing to say to developers is, don't tell me we can't do it. We put a man on the moon in 1969. What we are doing can't be that hard. Real Truck grew very slowly. An order would come in every other day or so. I would repeat the ordering process and direct my developer friend to do things to make the website better. At that time, only a web developer could do anything on the website, from adding products to making improvements. Changing the market. To add products, there were two big obstacles. Number one, a web developer doesn't like to do it. They prefer to do cool code stuff. Number two, if you have no money to stock products, you have to find and convince partners like manufacturers or wholesalers to set up an account for a virtual store and drop ship for you, then send back tracking. My web guy reluctantly added products as I was able to find manufacturers that would drop ship, which was a long and slow process. Often they didn't even have access to images for their products except to mail a printed catalog and price guide. I was still trying to convince the pickup truck accessory stores to sell online, and I even offered to let them clone the Real Truck website. Even with Real Truck having little success with sales, most were not interested. For the companies that were interested, we cloned the Real Truck website, and we provided them training and support. The problem was that none of them put any time, effort, or resources into making the site work for their company. If they did authorize an employee to work on it, it would be the person with the least authority and with the understanding that everything else is more important. Or at least, that is how it seems to me. As for finding more products, that was challenging. Most manufacturers we approached were very sure selling online would not work. No one is going to buy something they can't touch from a company that they've never heard of. You can sell staplers online, but not pickup accessories. I would share with them that we were having a little success selling online. They came up with all sorts of excuses why online selling would not work for their products. Most looked at a website as a marketing brochure. Some would build websites and not update them for 5 years. Even when faced with my sales data, they would deny the facts. If I was able to get by that, the next obstacle was that they felt it would take away from the local dealer business or their current mail-order dealers. A big manufacturer might have 1,000 dealers and a smaller one 100 dealers. I would point out that with 35,000 or so cities in the U.S., even with 1,000 dealers, there were huge gaps. The belief was that mail-order catalog companies were covering that gap. Some companies had convinced themselves that their customers would drive 100 miles to buy their product. Even then, I couldn't imagine someone driving 100 miles for a pair of Nerf bars. I would try to convince them that not everyone would drive to get products and that some folks might appreciate buying it online, having it show up at their door. They were also sure that the number of people who would buy a product and install it themselves was minimal, and also covered by mail-order companies. I kept at it, and very, very slowly, a manufacturer would say, sure, let's give it a try. Those more open-minded companies would, 10 years later, see e-commerce companies like Real Truck and Auto Anything make up a good share of their top 10 accounts. As for mail-order, Like brick-and-mortar stores, those companies often struggled with getting online and doing it right. They were too focused on their now business, which was mail order. In reality, if the J.C. Whitney and Steinland trucks of the world at that time had got going on this new people-connecting network, the Internet, they would be light years ahead. But as luck would have it, they didn't. And that gave Real Truck lots of time to find partners and figure things out. Once we were able to convince a pickup accessory manufacturer to let us sell their products, that led to more changes. No one had digital product images, videos, or even product data. It was all on printed brochures and printed application guides. Often, whoever created the printed brochure for the manufacturer didn't have a way to get the digital files they had to you. It could take a month to get whomever designed the printed literature to put it on a CD and mail it to us. We would take pictures of the brochures and load that, along with typing out the application guides in a manner that was conducive for online orders. I spent most of my evenings searching the Internet and submitting the Real Truck website to directories, search engines, and forums. At the time, there were what seemed like hundreds of search engines and literally thousands and thousands of specialty directories on the web, from state directories and hobby directories to industry and personal directories. It kept me busy for what seemed like months and months, but that helped folks find us online. Often the submission process was glitchy, so I would have to submit the same form 10 times. I would type out all the info, our address, what we sold, etc., click submit, and the site would wipe it out. And at the time, some of the forms to add your site had 100 questions. It seemed crazy, but every time I submitted Real Truck to a directory, it felt like things were going to be all right. I shared my findings with some of my pickup accessory store accounts, especially the few that had websites, with regards to products, submitting to search engines and directories for web traffic. Again, most would not put in the work. What would spending 15 minutes adding a site to one web directory do in the big scheme of things anyways? For some reason, I was very passionate that it was what was best. Little steps is how you climb a mountain. One step after another. Little hits rather than swinging for the fence. Little action after little action would add up over time. When Google started to become the number one search engine, followed by Yahoo and MSN, since we had thousands of listings on all those specialty directories and forums, we ranked better in the bigger search engines. We kept selling a little more and a little more, adding new products occasionally. In May 2000, I decided to sell Northwest representation to Greg Hoff, the sale rep who worked for me at the time. He would take over Northwest reps, and I would continue Real Truck as my little hobby business. We set up a deal, and he bought me out over the course of 3 years. I took a job again for Agri-Cover, Inc. as their national sales manager. That job kept us afloat personally, and I used the money I was getting from Greg each month to enhance the Real Truck website. We had enough business coming in that I began to hire employees to process orders. This continued from May 2000 until May 2003. We added products, sales increased, we hired more employees, and everything we made went into making the Real Truck website better. In 2003, we had about 5 employees. Full-time Real Truck. As Real Truck grew, my day job became more challenging. A lot of the accounts Agri-Cover had looked at Real Truck as a competitor. Your national sales manager is competing with us. We didn't see it that way. We saw that often someone would learn about the Access roll-up cover via Real Truck and the Internet. Some would buy it online, which was good for Agri-Cover and Real Truck. Others would print off the product from the Real Truck website, take it to a pickup accessory store, and that store would call Agri-Cover and ask to become a dealer. In that case, it was good for Agri-Cover and good for expanding the popularity of the Access roll-up cover. Agri-Cover was starting to sign dealers from all around the country. At that time, Agri-Cover was strong in the Great Plains states and in the Northwest, but spotty everywhere else. That changed rapidly. The Internet helped Agri-Cover get new dealers via finding their products on Real Truck and on the Agri-Cover website. Real Truck ranked way better and had more products, which was a bigger funnel for exposing folks to the products we had online. Real Truck was also getting some sales with those customers daring enough to buy online. In addition, the future sales for Agri-Cover directly from these new dealers from around the country was pretty sweet since they did not have the expense of a sales rep visiting them in person. I could tell it was getting to be too much to explain that to Agri-Cover's dealers. Real Truck was getting bigger, and I needed to be there full time. I owe a great debt of gratitude to Chuck and Steve, the owners of Agri-Cover, for the employment opportunity, helping me start Northwest representation, hiring me as their national sales manager, supporting me with Real Truck, teaching me about business, and so much more. During that time, another great thing happened. I was introduced to Mind Tremors, a web development company in Fargo, North Dakota, owned by Justin and Joshua Deltner, who are also twins. They became the web developers for Real Truck moving forward. Justin's wife, Kelly, was the project manager. Josh tended to do graphics and network stuff, and Justin did the heavier web development, although both could pretty much do it all. This is when we really stepped up our web development game. Now that I was at Real Truck full-time, it was really important we grow, since my family and employees were counting on me to make payroll twice a month. This increased the need to team up with more manufacturers. Even in 2003, 5 years later, it was still difficult to convince a manufacturer to let us sell their products online and have them dropship the orders. In the automotive industry, the big show of the year is in November, and it's called the SEMA, Specialty Equipment Marketing Association, show. I started going there when I worked at Agri-Cover as a factory rep before I had my manufacturer's rep firm, Northwest Reps. At Agri-Cover, I would not have been able to foresee I would be attending the show every year for the next 25 years. At the SEMA show, manufacturers exhibited their products. Wholesalers, local dealers, and mail-order companies in the automotive space would attend the show to see the manufacturers they were doing business with and to find new products to offer their customers. The automotive aftermarket is a big industry, and the show is massive, from spark plugs and batteries to rims and pickup bed covers. Pickup accessories were probably one of the smaller areas of the show at the time, but it was growing, and so was Real Truck. At this time, we also had a printed catalog. We did this because it made us appear less virtual, more like a mail-order company than an e-commerce company. That made finding new vendors a little easier. There was also a sentiment developing with the manufacturers that e-commerce companies were giving away products and discounting too much. The popular opinion was that e-commerce companies had no overhead, so they just hoarded up street pricing and sold everything for just a little above cost. Certainly some companies selling online were big discounters, and most of those would eventually go broke. I had learned at Agri-Cover there was an art between balancing volume and margin. I also had learned that profitability is directly tied to how well you buy. Meaning, the street price is the street price, and you can't really control that for a product. The market does. If you have really great service and really great delivery, perhaps you can be a little more expensive than the street price, as people will pay a little more for better service, but not a lot. So the best way to improve profit is to buy better and take advantage of early pay discounts, rebate programs, advertising co-op dollars, and so forth. One thing overlooked by the manufacturers regarding e-commerce companies was that they did have overhead, but it was a different kind. We didn't have inventory costs or nice-looking storefront costs. However, we did have web development expenses and marketing expenses. You can't live in North Dakota selling all over the U.S. without some marketing going on. Web development was our largest expense. We were putting virtually all of our profits into improving the site. We were often going into debt with creative leases for software development, maxing our lines of credit at the bank, and at one time, selling just about everything I owned and turning my house, Real Truck, and what seems like my life over to a banker to keep Real Truck going. We probably had about $1 million into website development at that point. I always looked at it a certain way. If an enhancement on our website cost 25,000, 50,000, or even 100,000 at the time, the improvement from whatever module, widget, program, or automation we developed would benefit us for years. If it created more efficiency operationally, more traffic, or a higher conversion rate, then it was a good investment to make. Unfortunately, or perhaps in my case fortunately, we had limited resources. So we had to choose our improvements wisely and make sure they were successful to get our future return on investment. Because of Justin and Josh Deltner, we were really doing some cool stuff. We set it up so people could add products to the website. During the SEMA show, I would meet with potential vendors, manufacturers, show them the printed catalog, and show them our website on my oversized laptop. Justin liked big laptops. Often traveling people joked that they didn't realize Commodore 64 made laptops. I'd explain we wouldn't over-discount, that we could grow their product and grow the market, that we paid our bills on time, and that if they set up with good pricing without having to buy inventory, it would be a good deal for both of us. With good images, product information, and easy-to-understand order controls, we could sell their product without someone touching or seeing it in person. A few would say, sure, let's give it a try. A few times, I offered a bet. If a vendor was on the fence, I would say, tell you what, I'll go back to my hotel room tonight and add your product to our site. And if we sell one online before the show is over, then you will set up as a dealer. If we don't sell one, then I won't bug you for another year, and I'll send you a good book to read from Amazon. If they agreed, I'd snap some pictures of their products on display with my digital camera, grab their printed literature and application guide, and thanks to Justin and Josh's product line editor, even I, with no web coding skills, could quickly add the products to the website. As good fortune would have it, I never lost the bet. For some of the products we were selling, RealTruck was starting to be on the top 10 account list for those manufacturers. That was pretty cool. Who would have thought? We grew every year, sold more, hired more people, invested more in development. Often I wondered if I was really qualified to lead RealTruck. It was growing rapidly. Was I qualified? Could I find someone who would do it better? At this time, my longtime friend Jeff Van Lanningham was working for another company. Out of college, he landed a job at Kraft Foods, then went on to Merck. When I had decided to leave Agri-Cover, I told Chuck he had to meet Jeff and should hire him to replace me. He did. Personally, I had always wanted to hire Jeff. I didn't want to hire him away from a big battleship onto my little boat, which could sink a lot easier. Then, as he mentioned in the foreword of this book, he lost his job and wanted to get working right away. I wanted to hire him badly. He was a seeker, always learning something new and then eager to share it with everyone. There was the time he started learning about colognes. I mean, he went deep. Oils, fragrances for this and that, which lasts longer, which works better for each season. This president wore this cologne, on and on. But I noticed he left a trail of guys smelling better in his wake. He's very insightful and one of the funniest guys you will ever meet. He also has a great marketing eye, even though he never went to school for that. But there was a problem. I could only afford to pay him about half of what he was making, and RealTruck was no Merck. If a big wave hit us, we would be fish food. He signed up. This would be another ingredient for our future success. Now, I realize some people say don't hire friends. I was kind of on the fence about it at the time. I was on a flight to Alaska on my way to an event and pondered this question. Should you hire a friend? Like a lightning bolt, it struck me. We spend 40 or more hours of our life every week working for what could be the next 40 years. I decided right then I prefer to do that with people I like. Now that doesn't mean everyone I like would work well with me. It just means, if there is a fit, I'd go with who I like. Later, I would notice I tended to hire folks based on two main things, trust and character. Could I trust them, and what is their character like? Skills can be learned or taught fairly easily. Trust and character, on the other hand, not so much. I learned that if you can get the right people in the right spots, work becomes easier. One of Jeff's many qualities is that he is able to focus, which is a challenge for me. I want to do 100 things all at the same time and have them all done yesterday. When I read the book Steve Jobs by Walter Isaacson, I painfully identified with the reality distortion field, RDF. I seem to have a similar trait. I was really good for removing obstacles and pushing people to get things done, but also very taxing on them. When they would say it will be done in a month, I'd say, no, we'll have it done by Friday. As Real Truck grew, having 100 important things that needed to be done by Friday wasn't realistic. Jeff would tell me. Jeff would pin me down and ask what were the 3 most important things we needed to do. He'd say, let's focus on those. You can still have your list of 100, but let's get folks having a top 3 in each department. It made sense, but I did have a tendency to turn the 3 we agreed on into 6 or 9 from time to time. This is when I started realizing more and more that not all people are going to be good at everything. If you have a customer service manager that is great at rah-rah fun and creating a great customer experience, they may suck at employee discipline. If they are great at employee discipline and lack the rah-rah skills, they may not have any employees still working. It's better to amplify what you're good at and let others help with what you're not good at. I began to realize this idea applies to me, but it also needed to apply to everyone else. I'm really good at seeing patterns. I would get so mad when others around me couldn't see what I see. For instance, wanting 100 things done at the same time, I expected everyone to be good at everything. Good at customer service, order fulfillment, vendor negotiations, managing, adding products, coming up with development ideas, improving processing, making decisions, taking calculated risks, being open-minded, editing images and video, understanding search engine optimization, calculating margin, and so on. Everyone had to be masters of all hard and soft skills. Thanks to Jeff, I know that this is not a realistic expectation, and I'm setting people up for failure. I began to realize that what was easy for me to see didn't mean it was easy for everyone else to see. That is where trust comes in to bridge the gap. It meant I needed to look for things people are good at rather than always focusing on what they're not. Jeff started as Real Truck's first vice president and went on to become president. Justin Deltner was our first direct hire web developer who would go on to be our CTO, chief technical officer. Those 2 gentlemen became my best fans, best critics, best advisors, and best evangelists for Real Truck. We were growing like crazy. We built a new facility with 1,400 square feet of warehouse space and 1,200 square feet of office space. I had the idea that if we warehoused some of the products, we could ship them faster and make a little more money. I thought since we figured out e-commerce and running a company, adding a warehouse would be no harder. This decision about killed us. First, it was expensive. And second, we had no idea how to run a warehouse. I thought, if we built it, the right person would come along and magically optimize warehouse operations. That didn't happen. For returns, we had always shipped them back to where we ordered them from, which was easy to get the return credit one product at a time. With a warehouse, vendors expected us to take returns back ourselves, and then every few months put them on a pallet and ship them back. A few issues with this. First, vendors were good about one-at-a-time credits. When there was $5,000 of returns on a pallet, they weren't the best at giving a full credit because it seemed like a lot at once. Second, returns piled up and they were hard to keep organized. For inventory management, even if we had $25,000 of stock for a given brand, we still had to dropship most of the orders, and we never seemed to have the right items in stock. Plus, with pickup accessories, you have big items, small items, and everything in between. One product, such as a chrome bug shield, might have 200 individual parts to fit various year, make, and model of vehicles, so we rarely had the right one in stock. When you organize the stock in the warehouse, do you do it by brand or by product category? We had no idea. What's the best way to rotate the stock? UPS was great at hooking us up with the technology we needed to run a warehouse, but we just didn't have any of the skills and talents to properly take advantage of it. Plus, with new vendors, since we had a warehouse, they would want us to order $10,000 or $20,000 of stock as an opening order and then dropship what we didn't have in stock, which greatly slowed down onboarding new vendors as we could only afford so much inventory. It was a crazy time. It was a difficult and challenging time. This was further compounded when our industry had its first huge kick in the pants. In 2007, new pickup sales started to slow and gas prices went through the roof. The market rapidly contracted. Fewer new pickups sold means less pickup accessories sold. Over the next couple of years, pickup sales continued to drop. Pickup sales would eventually drop 50% to what they were. How would we survive if our sales got cut in half? We saw sales starting to slow and we needed to get in a position to survive the downturn. Jeff said, "We're good at marketing online, good at automating the dropship process, and good at customer service. Let's stop trying to be great at everything." We decided to sell the facility and move into one that just had an office space. As luck would have it, a building supply company wanted to set up shop in town. Rather than build, they bought the facility. We took a loss on it, but it saved us big time on cash flow. Plus, having better focus on the three things rather than everything, we spent more time looking for partners that fit our business model. That model was dropship only. We looked at the numbers from when we had a warehouse, and it was true that because of stocking, we were able to buy products about 5% cheaper. However, running a warehouse along with the cost of inventory turnover cost us way more than 5%. We had always been a reasonably transparent company. I shared that we were in for some tough times, and we needed to tighten our belts to survive as we were starting to lose money. We needed to watch our spending, especially on marketing. We needed to cut costs anywhere we could, and that might even be payroll. Crunching the numbers, it looked like we needed to cut payroll by about 25%. I was sick to my stomach. I've never liked telling someone to take their ball and play elsewhere. Someone who enjoys letting someone go should never be in a position to do so, in my opinion. I absolutely hate it. Besides running the company effectively, later I would learn the best solution for not being put in a position to let someone go is to hire well. If someone wants to go, then I'd like to be in a position to help them get to where they want to go. Nobody likes rejection, and nobody likes being told their services were no longer needed. I certainly didn't like being the one saying it. This 25% reduction was a problem. The thought of laying off an employee was akin to telling a family member they had to go. What were we going to do? Jeff, Justin, and I had many conversations on it. Ultimately, we decided upper management would need to take a 30% pay cut, frontline managers a 10% pay cut. On the front line, such as customer service, returns, and order fulfillment, there would be no pay cuts. Those in management and upper management were in a better position to take the hit. To those whom much is given, much is expected. We were very transparent with everyone in the company on what was going on in the company and in the marketplace. We hoped these would be temporary cuts, but didn't know for sure. One manager left, taking a 10% cut was just too much, and he felt it was unfair. It was a good thing. This person was highly skilled, an individual rock star, falling into the classification of I would not hire them again because they felt smarter and more important than everyone else. They didn't want any kind of personal sacrifice for the company's problems. They would not have fit into the culture that was to come. So what happened with rapid market downturn and the cost-cutting? I had to max out our lines of credit, sell just about everything I had, and sign my life away to a banker, along with my house, to extend our credit line. Some e-commerce companies went broke. Manufacturers were raising prices. Shipping costs increased. It was nip and tuck for a while. As for real truck, we saw cost decreases and efficiency increases everywhere from the electric bill to automating some of the accounting processes. We became more efficient operationally by leaps and bounds. We got better at answering the phone faster. We couldn't afford to pay any overtime and had to make do. Even though the number of pickups sold was decreasing, our sales kept growing and growing. Eventually, our profitability was greater than expected. Everyone who took pay cuts returned to their original pay, and many got raises. We had company-wide bonuses and raised the base wage of the front lines. How did this happen with such a huge market downturn? It was a glimpse of what was to come. If you take care of employees, they will step up and make sacrifices for the good of their coworkers and the company. The racetrack. It was an exciting time of growth, learning, doing things we didn't think we could do. Learn how to lead more effectively. More customers, more employees, more partners. But it seemed like we were missing something. I was missing something. Even though we were starting to kill it in a business sense, I was starting to have to drag myself to work. It was losing its fun. My passion for business was fading. In trying to create some excitement personally, I got into circle track racing on dirt as a way to blow off steam and relax. I know what you're thinking. How can driving a dirt track race car into a corner at 70 miles an hour be relaxing? I'm not totally sure, but I do know it calms the mind down to a single thought when you're racing. How am I going to drive this car around the corner without blowing it off the track, running it into another car, or worse yet, hitting a wall? It was a challenge. I didn't know anything about fixing cars or racing. I'm not a very mechanical person. Growing up, we had a hammer and silverware we used to fix things. There are many lessons I learned in business and racing that seem to help each other. Like in business, unless you're naturally gifted, the three biggest things you need are persistence, determination, and open-mindedness. You also need some luck or good fortune. Just like in business, those who feel more lucky seem to be more lucky. I really sucked at driving. My first five races ended with me being towed off the track. I would overdrive, loop the car, accidentally run into other cars, hit the wall, or wind up in the catch fence. If you had seen me drive then, you would have told me to find a different hobby. It was a renewed challenge to learn how to drive a race car, how to fix things, how to read track conditions, and how to set up a car. In business, I learned that if you want to speed up your learning curve, ask questions. Lots of them. And like in business, if you want to grow, you need to focus on what you're doing, not on what others are doing. It's hard to steer a car or a business if all your time is spent looking at who or what is beside you. The best drivers usually have really good down-the-track vision. If you find yourself getting into a lot of wrecks, it's because you're looking at the bumper of the car in front of you, so when something does happen, you don't have enough time to react. Those who look way down the track seem to be able to stay out of more wrecks. You can't win if you don't finish, and you can't finish if you're in a lot of wrecks. Just like in business, the further you can look ahead, the better. It gives you more time to plan and adjust. You don't have to win to be a winner. If you do better than expected, that can be more rewarding than winning. What I mean is, I sucked at racing, but as I was learning, I slowly got better. My expectations were relatively low. Just finishing a race was a goal. I would be ecstatic to finish. Then I started getting top tens, then top fives, and then eventually got lucky and won a race. My first win, I was shocked. I had not arrived at the track expecting to win. As the years went by, my wins increased. I was continuing to learn. I was getting better. Then something happened that changed the way I looked at my racing. I won second in a really big race. I was totally shocked. I wanted to jump on the roof of the car and scream, "Holy shit, I got second!" I went to the race just hoping to make the feature event. I had already won by getting to race the feature. There were about 80 cars at the event, and only 24 would make the feature. Getting second in the feature was icing on the cake. I went over to the winner of the race to congratulate him. I shook his hand and said, "Great job." He didn't seem very happy. I went and congratulated the guy who got third, and he also didn't seem very happy. I thought about it, and the next time I saw them, I asked them why they didn't seem very happy with their respective results. The winner said, "Well, I was hoping to lap more of the field than I did." The third place finisher said he had started on pole and it was his race to win, but he didn't. He felt he should have won. In both cases, their expectations got the best of them. Turns out, winning doesn't give you as much personal satisfaction as doing better than you thought you would. And if you expect to win all the time, you will be disappointed more, even when you do win. If you've never been to a circle dirt racetrack, go check it out sometime. You will see competition, community, and passion. You will see a competitor helping another competitor fix his or her car to get back on the track for the next race. You will see someone win that you never thought would. You will see a 14-year-old kid wheel by the local track champion and beat him. You will see a guy win, who takes off his helmet and looks like your grandpa has been racing for 50 years, or in some cases, just started racing. You will see disappointment and redemption. You will see a fleet of volunteers helping with everything from track prep to officiating. You will see fans cheering for their favorite drivers, win or not. You will see a pack of loud and powerful race cars going into a corner super fast and somehow all coming out of it without running into each other, like a choreographed scene that will amaze you. And yes, sometimes you will see wrecks and chaos, which I'm not a big fan of. NASCAR gets a lot of attention, but if you want to see some exciting racing, go check out your nearest dirt track. It's like a small hometown diner, one where you'll find some of the best food on earth. For some, they go once and they are hooked for life. Others don't see much value in it. For me, it's entertaining, challenging, and also rewarding. Racing is also where I picked up the nickname, the Red-Headed Rebel. Back to the purpose of the book. The next chapter explains how we utterly failed at getting principles into the culture on our first attempt. We went back to the drawing board and tried again with a very different approach. Persistence paid off, and we got it right on the second try.